Hello. In this video, we will talk about factors affecting drug absorption for individual routes. Let's get started. First, oral route. The factors that affect the absorption of oral drugs are degree of ionization, gastric emptying, degradation and extrusion of drugs, presence of food, concurrently administered drugs, first pass effect, and finally, gastrointestinal diseases. First, let's talk about the degree of ionization. See, the drug molecules exist in two interconvertible forms, non-ionized and ionized. Now, the biological membrane is made up of lipids and is permeable to only non-ionized molecules. So only the non-ionized portion of the drug is absorbed. Ionized molecules, on the other hand, cannot be absorbed. Now, the degree of ionization depends on the pH of the medium. How all this is relevant to absorption? Let's see. In this schematic diagram, the upper part is the stomach, and the lower part is the intestine. The stomach has an acidic medium due to acidic secretion, and the intestine has a basic medium due to basic secretion. Here we will see all possible scenarios. What happens with acidic drugs in the stomach and the intestine? And what happens with basic drugs in the stomach and intestine? First, basic drugs in the intestine. As we just saw, drug molecules exist in two interconvertible forms, non-ionized and ionized. Now, intestinal secretion is basic. In such an environment, basic drugs largely get converted into non-ionized forms. As this form is absorbed better, basic drugs are absorbed better from the intestine. On the other hand, secretion from the stomach is acidic. In a such medium, the basic drug would largely get converted into the ionized form. So, the portion of non-ionized form would be small. So basic drugs are poorly absorbed from the stomach. In short, basic drugs are absorbed better from the intestine. Now let's talk about acidic drugs. In the intestine, due to the basic environment, the acidic drug largely gets converted into an ionized form. So, the portion available for absorption is small. On the other hand, in the stomach, due to an acidic medium, these drugs largely get converted to a non-ionized form. So the portion available for absorption is large. Okay, if everything is clear so far, get ready for a surprise. Here, although a larger portion is available for absorption, the actual absorption is small. The reason is the mucosa in the stomach is thick, is covered with thick mucus, and also the surface area of the stomach is small. Whereas, with the intestine, there are no such problems. Rather, due to villi, a much larger surface area is available for absorption here. So even for acidic drugs also, absorption mainly occurs from the intestine only. Here you might ask, only a small portion is available for absorption, then how can absorption mainly occur in the intestine? Well, the answer is, as the non-ionized molecules get absorbed, their concentration falls. This allows the conversion of ionized molecules into non-ionized ones. And then, they are also absorbed. This keeps on happening. And as the drug stays for a much longer time in the intestine, there is enough time for absorption in this way also. If you are very intelligent, you might ask, well, then the basic drugs should also be absorbed from the stomach. Yes, your point is valid. But remember, the thick mucosa, mucus, small surface area, and shorter stay in the stomach are limiting factors here. In a nutshell, both types of drugs are mainly absorbed from the intestine. And now you know the exact reason. So this was about ionization. Our next factor is related to this only. It's gastric emptying. The gastric emptying sends the drug into the intestine. Here, the absorption is better, as we have just discussed. So, faster gastric emptying makes the absorption faster. And delayed gastric emptying makes the absorption slower. So this was gastric emptying. The next factor is degradation. Some drugs are degraded in gastrointestinal tract and therefore not absorbed. For example, gastric acid destroys penicillin G. And enzyme peptidase degrades insulin. Because of such degradation, many drugs are not effective when given by oral route. Next is extrusion. The gut epithelial cells contain an efflux transporter called P-glycoprotein. Some of the absorbed drug molecules are extruded back into the lumen by them. This decreases the bioavailability of certain drugs, like digoxin and cycloserine. So this was about degradation and extrusion. Next is the presence of food. Usually, food decreases absorption. There are a few reasons behind this. 1. The food dilutes the drug, which slows down the rate of absorption, as we have seen in the previous video. 2. It may form complexes with drugs that are poorly absorbed. For example, calcium in milk makes complex with tetracyclines, which are poorly absorbed. And finally, the food delays gastric emptying. And as we saw earlier, this delays absorption. Thus, usually, the food retards absorption. But it's not always true. For some drugs, food might actually increase absorption. For example, fatty food increases the absorption of lumefantrine and griseofulvin. And vitamin C keeps iron in the ferrous form, which is absorbed better. So this is how food affects drug absorption. Similar to food, concurrently administered drugs can also affect absorption. For example, hematinics containing iron reduce the absorption of tetracyclines. Liquid paraffin decreases the absorption of fat-soluble vitamins A, D, E, and K. So this was about food and concurrent drugs. The next factor is more interesting. It's first-pass metabolism. The drug absorbed from the intestine first passes through portal veins and the liver, and then enters the systemic circulation. During this passage, some portions of the drug might get degraded by metabolizing enzymes, especially in the liver. Because of this, the bioavailability of certain drugs is decreased. This degradation of a drug that occurs before it reaches the systemic circulation is called first-pass metabolism. Drugs showing significant first-pass metabolism are levodopa, nitroglycerin, propranolol, etc. So this was first-pass metabolism. The last factor affecting absorption by the oral route is gastrointestinal diseases. For example, gastroenteritis decreases the absorption of drugs. In celiac disease, absorption of amoxicillin and pivampicillin is decreased, whereas absorption of cephalexin is increased. So these were all the factors affecting absorption by oral route. Next, subcutaneous and intramuscular routes. Here, heat and exercise increase blood flow and thereby increase absorption. We have already seen how increased blood flow increases absorption in the previous video, so we won't repeat it here. That's it for these routes. Talking about topical administration, abrasions on the surface increase absorption. So these were all the factors depending on the route of the administration. Please note that in intravenous administration, 100% drug directly enters the systemic circulation. So there is nothing to be affected here. So these were all the factors affecting absorption. Now let's have a quick summary. In the oral route, the degree of ionization affects how much portion of the drug is available for absorption. However, most of the drug is absorbed from the intestine, regardless of ionization, because of the higher surface area of the intestine. For the same reason, gastric emptying increases absorption. Degradation and extrusion decrease the absorption of some drugs. The presence of food and concurrently given drugs also affect the absorption. First-pass metabolism decreases the bioavailability of some drugs. Gastrointestinal diseases also affect absorption. In the subcutaneous and intramuscular routes, heat, and exercise increase absorption by increasing blood flow. On topical administration, abrasion on the surface increases absorption. Bioavailability in the intravenous route is 100%, and nothing can affect this. That's it for this video. You can find notes and explore our entire animation video library on our website. The links are in the description. If you liked this video, please share it with your friends and colleagues too. And don't forget to subscribe, because lots more to come. At Nonstop Neuron, learning medical concepts is as easy as watching cartoons. Thanks for watching, see you in the next video.